Hi, everybody, and welcome back to this week's edition of the New Variety Art Show. We finally afforded some more tape, so we're back here to do another show for you. My name is Brad Zinn. I'm your host of the New Variety Arts Show, where we have a chance to explore variety arts in the 90s. We invite variety arts performers on the show so we can get to know them one-on-one, and hopefully the next time you see a variety arts performer live and in person, you'll appreciate what they do just a little bit more. And we'd like to hear from you out there, if you're watching, at this telephone number, area code. That is the number to get in touch with us here on the New Variety Arts Show. We'd like to hear from you, what you think of the show. If you have any ideas for the show, or if you have any events coming up that feature variety artists, we'd like to hear from you. We'll try to start a little calendar on the show and let folks know where they can come and enjoy entertainment and variety arts live and in person. Here's somebody we'd like you to meet right now, our musical director, as always, back once again, Van Coriton.
I'm back again.
Back again.
Can't stay away.
We tried, but we just can't.
My car just goes in this direction.
Well, I think it has something to do with the weather, doesn't it?
Yes, it seems every time we're in the studio, it either rains or threatens to rain.
It's bad weather always. I don't know.
It's magic.
I guess so. Tell us again where people can come and see you.
They can come see. By the way, it's a great place to watch a thunderstorm at the Phoenician.
Yes.
Phoenician Resort, really. Right where the view is in front of the tea court.
Beautiful, in front of the tea court.
Right. There's a beautiful Steinway concert grand.
Uh-huh.
There I am to be found.
Little
it's much
finger
longer
sandwiches.
Than this.
Yes. Yeah. Little finger sandwiches. And
yes, from Chef Dahmer.
Right. Chef Dahmer. Well, we're glad you're here, Van. We want to mention about where some of the performers that have been on the show can be seen.
Oh, yeah, people ask.
Flash Covington can be seen at Rawhide. Gene Urban at number 10 Downing Street. Kevin Barnes is up in Las Vegas at the Excalibur Hotel. Jay Malbro, Crazy Jay, is at the Adobe Oven in Ahaha.
Uh-huh.
And Kim Welsh, our friend, is at the Hop over in Glendale.
Uh-huh.
So,
and where can you be found?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. I didn't think you'd ask. We're getting ready, folks, to do our full evening show. Once a year I come out of retirement and we do our full evening Magic and Illusion show at the Phoenix College Auditorium. That's to benefit the Phoenix Breakfast Civitan Club. It is Thursday, June 25th at 7:30 p.m. Tickets available at the door. Doors will open at 7 p.m. So please come on out and join us and help support a worthy cause.
Great.
Right now we want to tell you about our guest today. I don't know how we do this week after week after week. We get top great guests
magic,
in here, and
I'm
it's a lot of fun. It is. And that's our topic for today, magic. Our guest is a world-renowned illusionist. He's traveled all over the world. He's been seen in over 75 different countries around
wow.
the globe, and of course in every state in the United States. He is a performer as well as a creator of illusions. He actually comes up with the ideas.
Hmm.
I'm not as creative as that.
Yeah.
And he is also a very close advisor to David Copperfield.
Hmm.
Probably the number one magician today. But our guest concerts are sellouts also wherever he goes. His shows are sponsored by the Campus Crusade for Christ, and he travels all over the world, making him the number one evangelical
wow.
magician of our time. We have a, let me see if we can hold this up and get a picture of this. This is one of his latest creations. It is the walking on water illusion, and we're going to talk to him about that just a little bit later on, walking on water. But right now, we have a clip of our guest performing some of these original illusions that he has created, and we want you to take a look at that. And when we come back, we'll meet Andre Kole. Don't go away.
London, Paris, Cairo, Buenos Aires. Millions of people in 74 countries of the world have witnessed the incomparable performances of Andre Kole and his magical spectacular. Andre Kole is not only the inventor of the illusions in his own show, but he is also a creative consultant to the best-known magicians in the world today.
Hello, my name is David Copperfield. Through the years, Andre Kole has not only been one of my closest friends, but he's also been a creative consultant for my TV specials. Several years ago, Andre assisted me with the development of my most famous illusion, the disappearance of a Statue of Liberty. In his live stage show this year, Andre will be presenting his original stage version of the illusion, using a replica of the statue weighing several hundred pounds. I don't know of any other magician who would attempt such a difficult challenge right on stage. Don't miss it.
Illusion and reality collide in Andre Kole's world of illusion. Don't miss the magical and the inspirational experience that you will remember as long as you live, and perhaps even longer.
Absolutely incredible illusions brought to you by our guest today, Andre Kole. Van, I don't know how we got so lucky to get him here.
I don't know how we got him.
Because we don't even pay scale for this. David Copperfield says, and I quote, "Don't miss this opportunity to see some of the most incredible illusions ever conceived." And I couldn't agree more. Our very special guest today and a good friend, Mr. Andre Kole. Thank you for being here.
Ryan, great to be here.
You are so busy on the road, on tour, going, traveling all over the world that we count ourselves very fortunate to have you here today. Some people watching may recognize you from, if they were a few years back, you were a guest artist on The Magician with Bill Bixby, the TV series that was running, and you performed one of your original illusions, The Table of Death, on that program. There was some license taken with it to make the story work. But that show with Bill Bixby, the magician, back in the late 70s, early 80s, somewhere in that neighborhood, would you consider that to be the kind of the start of the rebirth of interest, current day interest in magic?
I think it even goes farther back to the time of Mark Wilson's Magic Land of Alakazam, the Magic Circus, and then even prior to that, I think it was Melbourne Christopher that had a few specials on. So going on back, but that was a long-running show, and there was something interesting that happened on that show with Bill Bixby. In the first part of the show, I try and perform the Table of Death, and it looks like I get killed. And then in the story later on, he has to come on and try and do the same effect. Well, in his presentation of it, they were taping, and I saw that he was not going to make it, and I had to run in and stop the action, or Bill Bixby would have actually been killed.
Oh my goodness.
For real on that show.
So not only a magician, but a hero as well. Well, I'm sure Bill Bixby owes you a great debt of gratitude. You are a native of Mesa, is that correct? You were born and raised, grew up in the Mesa area?
I've been here since the beginning.
Since the beginning, when this was just a dirt plateau. Tell us how you first became interested in magic. I know that there was a very special man in your life by the name of Moxo the Magician. Can you tell us just briefly how you got started?
Well, it actually started when I was about 7 years old. My mother bought me a little magic book for Christmas called Peter Rabbit the Magician, and it had some little sleight of hand tricks. And then about 2 years later, I met Moxo, who made his winter home in the Mesa area. So he showed me a few tricks, and I had very little help beyond that, so that forced me to be creative, and that's how my creating inventions came along.
I see. So you didn't have a lot of exposure to store-bought magic tricks, and therefore if you wanted to continue to perform, you had to come up with your own stuff.
Right.
Well, that kind of answers that. Now, one of the most important aspects of your life is traveling on behalf of the Campus Crusade for Christ. I don't know quite how to say that, sponsored by or traveling on behalf of, but you are heavily involved with the Campus Crusade for Christ, and in your programs that you do hundreds of every year around the world, you share an evangelical message with your audiences. How did you first come into contact with the Campus Crusade, and how did that relationship develop?
Well, I know it's a strange combination. But it was when I was about 25 years old, I had a couple good friends in show business who were very successful, but they both committed suicide. And it was this that caused me to begin asking some of the serious questions of life, such as why am I here, where am I going, is there any real meaning and purpose to life? And because of my interest in magic, I've also had a great interest in investigating the unusual as I've traveled throughout the world. So someone challenged me as a magician and as a skeptic to investigate the miracles of Christ from the point of view of a magician. And it was in making that investigation I discovered some things that made a great impact upon my life. So in my shows, I do all the illusions of making people appear, disappear, dematerialize, and levitate. But in the at one section in the show, I share my experience, how I found this personal relationship with God, and I use a magic illustration to share that.
Uh-huh. And so, how is that received by your audiences?
It's tremendous because I don't talk about religion. I make that very clear that I'm not here to talk about religion, but rather about a relationship, that true Christianity is not a religion, but a relationship. And the results, thousands of people every week say that those few minutes were some of the most significant few minutes they'd ever spent in their life.
Now, you pass out little cards and things to the audience during your program. Do you keep track of how successful you are in bringing people to Christ?
Yes, there are well over 1,000 a week who indicate their desire to want to know God in a personal way. And
that's unbelievable. You're also an author. Let's talk quickly about your book. What is the name of it again?
Miracles or Magic.
Miracles or Magic. And what does this cover? Does this tell us how you do it?
Not so much on the magic tricks, but everybody wants to see and experience the supernatural. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, we're very vulnerable. And there are people all over the world who are using tricks in order to deceive the people. So what this book deals with is my investigation over the past 25 years in 74 countries of the world. Uh-huh. Such things as the witch doctors in Africa, or the Bermuda Triangle mystery, the investigation I made for Time magazine of the psychic surgeons in the Philippines.
This is very interesting. Let me touch on this some more. Would Uri Geller, the guy that bends keys and spoons with his mind, is this the kind of thing that you're talking about?
That's the type of thing.
Yeah. Now, he claims that he can go up in a helicopter and fly over somewhere and tell you where there's oil. Do you believe him? Can he do it?
No.
No? Can't
now,
do
he
it.
He might do it occasionally. But if you keep track of the records, it's like astrology or the psychics who make the predictions. If you keep records, you find they miss about 89%.
I see. So 11% is well within the realm of chance.
Right.
Is that right? Okay. Now, let's talk quickly, because you mentioned this, the psychic surgery. This was fascinating. I've seen photos. I'm sorry you didn't bring them. Maybe next time when you come back, you can bring some photos. These people are performing surgery without making an incision and apparently removing tumors and things.
It looks like they can reach right through the skin of the body, remove the diseased tissues and organs, and as they pull the hand out of the body, the skin apparently closes over and there's no trace of any incision. At least that's the illusion.
Right.
But in my investigations, I found that basically what they do is use some clotted beef's blood that they put in some cotton, and they hide these little cotton balls at various places. Most of the operations take place on the stomach area.
Right.
They use a lot of cotton water. They begin to massage the area, get one of the cotton balls, and they hold the thumb down, and it forms a cavity in the stomach, and they open the cotton ball, remove the diseased, the tissue or whatever they had
and
with
the
cotton ball.
And the tragedy of this is people believe they're cured, but actually nothing has happened, except perhaps the power of the mind telling them that they're cured, they feel better.
It's a tremendous placebo effect.
Right.
So they're not healed by the operations, which are complete fake, but as a result of this powerful psychological effect that these fake operations have on these people.
Now, before we go any further, are we ready to show this other clip? Because I want to leave plenty of time to do this. This is a clip of one of your latest and probably one of your greatest creations. It's called Walking on Water. We want you to see this, watch your TV, and when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about where Andre is going to be. Here now is Walking on Water.
The tank you see is capable of holding the 2,000 pounds of water that is contained in the two large upright tanks on each side.
This tank is also equipped with an air bubble hose and lights under the tank to show that nothing is concealed in the water or in the tank. The crystal and the pyramid. Two symbols of the new age, both have been attributed with many unusual and miraculous powers. However, in my investigations throughout the world, I have not found any evidence to support this belief. But if the crystal did contain some powers, then something similar to what you're about to see might be possible. Gentlemen, would you bring the two side tanks into position, please? And now, will you fill the tank part way up? Ladies and gentlemen, to my knowledge, I am the first person in the past 2,000 years who has attempted a public demonstration of walking on water, either with or without trickery. Now, I will have to admit my attempts have not always been successful. And when I'm not successful, I'm not only very embarrassed, but I'm also all wet. But tonight, I promise to give it my best effort. So I hope that you'll wish me luck.
How does he do it? I don't know. That's an incredible illusion, Andre, walking on water. And this is your most recent, is that right? Most current thing?
I'm always working on about a dozen new illusions. Uh-huh. And that's what makes it exciting, always creating something new.
Now, you work with David Copperfield an awful lot as well and helping him with things. What are some of the things that we've seen that that people can say, oh, that's part of what Andre did?
Well, in his current show, two of the illusions he's using that I invented was the where he's squeezed down.
Oh, uh-huh, shrinking. We saw a little bit of that in the first clip, yeah,
and
with the girl.
And then another illusion that we saw in the clip that he's doing in the show now is the head mover, my head mover, taking the head
right,
off.
Right, where the girl sets and then the head,
moving,
but he moves it off to another box.
To another table.
Little different version of that. That's incredible. How is he possibly going to top himself next year after flying? That's a great illusion.
Well, we were working on that about 2 or 3 hours ago. I was on the phone with him, and we were discussing three different possibilities that we might
So the decision hasn't been made yet.
The decision probably will not
be
made tomorrow.
We are part of magical history, Van. We are in the process.
Wouldn't doubt it.
Tell us real quick about your upcoming tour, because you're going overseas this summer.
In a few days,
right?
I leave for Bangkok, Thailand.
Now, there's a lot of rioting and stuff going on. Is that all kind of settled down? Or are you going to go?
In the past few weeks, they've had the worst political violence in the past 17 years. But right now, it is at this moment, it looks like it's over, so this is a perfect time for us to be going in. So we'll be there about 2 weeks, then we go to the Republic of China, and from the Republic of China, we go to Japan.
Now, the Republic of China, this is
Taiwan.
Taiwan, not
Taiwan.
The mainland.
Right.
Have you been to the mainland?
Yes.
And how were you received there? Because they're, more of a Buddhist type country?
Well, Thailand is Buddhist. Most countries I go to are other religions, but they are just a tremendous response.
Uh-huh. And did you say Japan? I'm sorry.
Japan, yes.
Japan. What part of Japan?
I'll be in Osaka.
Osaka, Japan.
Right.
Now, you love Oriental food, is that right? You told me one time you love Oriental food.
Well, I don't. I'd rather have Mexican food any day.
Well, do you get to Central and South America at all?
Yes, I've been in every country in Central and South America.
Unbelievable. Well, this is a man who is tremendously dedicated to what he does, because if you think about it, folks, he has to take an awful lot of shots and inoculations before he can go on tour. I think if I saw all those needles coming at me, Van, I'd think twice about leaving
too.
The old good old U.S. of A. Where can people expect to see you back here in the United States, and when? We're taping now in June of 92. So this is your summer tours overseas in the Orient. When will you be back here in the States?
I return to the United States last part of August. Then I begin a tour in September. I think it's in the southeast part of the United States, and then we gradually work west.
And do you have some idea of when you might be back in the Valley of the Sun area?
I sure don't.
Sure
Probably
don't.
Be at least a year.
Okay, about a year, maybe in reruns. We will be a little closer to the time that you're going to be here in the Valley. Nevertheless, folks, if you're anywhere near where Andre Kole is performing, do not miss the opportunity to see this man. And now on a personal note, I must tell you that you were one of the first magicians that I ever saw perform live. And you have been an inspiration to me over the years, and certainly one of my idols. And it's been very special to have you here with me.
Thank
on
you.
The show here today. I wish you nothing but continued success and luck. If I could be just as a tenth as talented as this gentleman, I'd be happy.
You are, Brad.
Well, thank you. Your check is in the mail, Van. We would like to remind you, since Andre does not have a show coming up, come see us at the Phoenix Breakfast Civitan Club, June 25th at Phoenix College Auditorium. Where
Great
is
show.
The future of
I've
magic headed? Thank you. Where is the future of magic headed?
It's hard to
leave.
Say in a far distance, because it's just bite-sized pieces. We get this far, and then we figure out where we're going to go from there. So it's kind of like that.
Well, whatever the future is, you're going to be a part of that horizon. Thank you again, Andre Kole. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in. Thanks, Van, for being here again. We're going to say goodbye, because we're out of tape. Roll those credits and support Variety Arts in your community. Bye-bye, everybody.